Pramay, and thank you so much for joining. So we'll start off with the Mangalacharan prayers, and then as the more and more devotees join, then we can get started. ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनाशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरुवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यामनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपा कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकम् वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरोः श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरून् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजात्मानं सहगणारघुनाथान्वितं त्वं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनासहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादां सहगणाललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितंश्च हे कृष्णकरुणासिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेशगोपिकाकान्ता राधाकान्तनमोऽस्तु ते तप्तकाञ्चनागौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभयश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्रीअद्वैता गदाधरा श्रीवासदि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 रामा हरे रामा 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 हरे हरे मत्समो नास्ति पापात्मा न पराधी च कश्चन परिहारे लज्जा मे किं ब्रुवे पुरुषोत्तम भूमौ स्खलितपादानां भूमिरेवावलम्बनं त्वयि जातापराधानां त्वामेव शरणं प्रभो गोविन्दवल्लभे राधे प्रार्थये त्वमहं सदा त्वदीयं इति जानातु गोविन्दो मां त्वया सह राधा राधितराधेश राधिका प्राणवल्लभ राधारमण वन्दे त्वं राधिका प्रेमनिर्जिता हरे कृष्ण सो आई वेलकम ऑल द डिवोटीज हु हैव जॉइंड हियर वेलकम यशोदा कृपा प्रभु नाइस टू सी यू अगेन एंड दुर्गा एंड all the devotees that have joined for the Karna Prabhu Hare Krishna. Srimad Bhagavatam is what is called spotless Purana. One of the biggest considerations of modern times. In fact, that was a question that was asked by the sages at Naimisharanya 5,000 years ago, when they all assembled to hear from Suta Goswami. There are so many scriptures. And in each of those scriptures, there are so many duties and rules and regulations. So please give us the essence of all these scriptures. And help us cut through this clutter of confusion that is existing in our hearts. If the sages of Naimisharanya, who were well qualified, who were well versed in all the Vedic literatures 5,000 years ago, had this difficulty, then what could be said of the modern context where information is just exploding at incredible pace because of internet and because of so many other things that are going on? The modern man is ever confused more and more about what exactly constitutes knowledge and what exactly constitutes reality. And the answer to that question, the essence of all scriptures, lies in Srimad Bhagavatam. And by reading the stories of Srimad Bhagavatam, they are not only really pleasing to the heart, they are not only ever fresh and new, but they dry up an ocean of the material miseries that the conditioned soul faces. If you think that I am making up this claim, if you refer to the 12th canto, 12th chapter, the 50th verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, it is mentioned, Tadeva Ramyam Ruchiram Navam Navam, Tadeva Shashvan Manaso Mahotsavam, Tadeva Shokar Navashoshanam Nanam, Yaduttama Shloka Yashonu Giyate. That the living entity has been traversing since time immemorial this impregnable fortress called material existence. The material existence creates a bewildering patterns of different kinds of engagements and desires in the conditioned soul with a view to enjoy this matter. And more often than not, that sort of endeavor is not going to give complete happiness. In fact, in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna mentions it, the result is usually the opposite. Yehi samsparshaja bhoga dukkha yonaya evate adyanta vantukanteya nateshuramate buddha. In fact, he says that yehi samsparshaja bhoga. Here Krishna uses samsparsha, which means complete attachment to sense gratification. We also, those who are on the path of the devotion or yoga path, they still have to have some connection with sense gratification. As in, everybody needs to eat prasadam, or is it just me? We need to eat prasadam. We need to eat something to live. We need a place. We need clothes. We need, for the event, if you are in the US, we need car. And for that, you need to work. So these all actually necessitate an engagement with the senses and sense objects, and you cannot deny it. But when the life becomes from samsparsha bhoga, from sparsha bhoga to samsparshaja bhoga, which means complete attachment to senses, then the result, Krishna says, dukkha yonaya evate. Because the more you try to dig in into the material nature, the more you get a sense of frustration, because things will never be the same. As we have experienced in the modern time, and you can see that there is COVID, and then lo behold, on August 15th, at least from those who are in California, which I feel most of the audience members are, we had thunderstorms and lightning, for crying out loud. I mean, we barely experienced it. Long time Bay Area residents will attest to that fact. We didn't experience those kinds of freakish once in I don't know how many years storm. And then there were forest fires, and then there were, this is the nature of this world. One way or other, it is just going to be like this. Now you might say, well, in the past, what do you think in the past? In the past, it must have been good. I mean, like, nostalgia is another thing people try to jump into. Nostalgic, you know, oh, the good old days. Let me assure you, my dear members of audience, there was no good old days. There are old days, sure, but every time in this world is such that there is danger at every step. Today, we will we will read the pastimes of Maharaj Ambarish and Durvasa from the ninth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. We will just take a peek at since time immemorial, because Bhagavatam gives not just the good old days, but the days that were filled with dangers. And if you see every canto, practically every chapter, there is some vexation or other going on in Srimad Bhagavatam. It starts off with Vedavyas being despondent, and then you can see it on and on it goes. Then Bhishma's lying on the deathbed, Uttara, you know, facing this danger. There were situations which are perplexing and just the nature of material existence. So I humbly request that we'll do the read along. We have just 14 to 15 devotees. And then we will do the pastime of Maharaj Ambarish from Srimad Bhagavatam. It starts off from the ninth canto and then the fourth chapter. We can start off with text number 13. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So I humbly request Shraddha Mataji to do like 10 translation of 10 verses, and that way we can discuss.
Thank you so much, Shastabu. So starting from text 13, from Nabhaga, Maharaj Ambarish took birth. Maharaj Ambarish was an exalted devotee, celebrated for his great merits. Although he was cursed by an infallible Brahmana, the curse could not touch him. King Parishad inquired, "O great personality, Maharaj Ambarish was certainly most exalted and meritorious in character. I wish to hear about him. How surprising it is that the curse of a Brahmana, which is insurmountable, could not act upon him." Text 15 and 16. Shukdev Goswami said, Maharaj Ambarisha, the most fortunate personality, achieved the rule of the entire world consisting of seven islands and achieved inexhaustible, unlimited opulence and prosperity on earth. Although such a position is rarely obtained, Maharaj Ambarish did not care for it at all, for he knew very well that all such opulence is material. Like that which is imagined in a dream, such opulence will ultimately be destroyed. The king knew that any non-devotee who attains such opulence merges increasingly into material nature's mode of darkness. Maharaj Ambarish was a great devotee of the Supreme Personality of Godhead Vasudeva and of the saintly persons who are the Lord's devotees. Because of this devotion, he thought of the entire universe as being insignificant as a piece of stone. Text 18 to 20. Maharaj Ambarish always engaged his mind in meditating upon the lotus feet of Krishna, his words in describing the glories of the Lord, his hands in cleansing the Lord's temple, and his ears in hearing the words spoken by Krishna or about Krishna. He engaged his eyes in seeing the deity of Krishna, Krishna's temples and Krishna's places like Mathura and Vrindavan. He engaged his sense of touch in touching the bodies of the Lord's devotees. He engaged his sense of smell in smelling the fragrance of Tulasi offered to the Lord, and he engaged his tongue in tasting the Lord's prasad. He engaged his legs in walking to the holy places and temples of the Lord, his head in bowing down before the Lord, and all his desires in serving the Lord 24 hours a day. Indeed, Maharaj Ambarish never desired anything for his own sense gratification. He engaged all his senses in devotional service in various engagements related to the Lord. This is the way to increase attachment for the Lord and be completely free from all material desires. Text 21. In performing his prescribed duties as a king, Maharaj Ambarish always offered the results of his royal activities to the Supreme Personality of Godhead Krishna, who is the enjoyer of everything and is beyond the perception of material senses. He certainly took advice from Brahmanas who were faithful devotees of the Lord, and thus he ruled the planet Earth without difficulty. Text 22. In desert countries where there flowed the river Saraswati, Maharaj Ambarish performed great sacrifices like the Ashwamedha Yajna and thus satisfied the master of all Yajnas, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Such sacrifices were performed with great opulence and suitable paraphernalia and with contributions of Dakshina to the Brahmanas, who were supervised by great personalities like Vashishta, Asita, and Gautama, representing the king, the performer of the sacrifices.
Thank you. So one point here is that even though he was a ruler of the earth, he ruled it without difficulty because he was taking the guidance of Brahmanas. That is the first point. And then Srila Prabhupada writes that if you, in the Bhagavad Gita, he says that one is, should be desireless, means that one should desire for Krishna. And oftentimes that seems a little incompatible, but we can see if you desire Krishna, then all the other desires might not seem to be that much of value, as much as one who has tasted the higher sweetness in yoga feels a little bit not that inclined for happiness that is really temporary. Vishyavini vartante niraharasya dehina rasavarjam rasopyasya parandrishvani vartate. And it's a fact, if we can practically experience it, those even very new devotees, those who come and hear about the transcendental names of the Lord, you know, at very after just for a few months, exposing for a few months, their taste for hearing mundane music, which they were so inclined and used to previously, that doesn't really appeal to them because there is the higher taste. So we can see that how Maharaj Ambarish, he was tremendously opulent and wealthy, and he had the complete control of the entire planet Earth without worrying about re-elections and campaigns and funds and so on and so forth. And he was still humble, thinking that this all will pass. And that's what is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita, that the devotee who is perfected in the process of yoga and who is absorbed in the Lord sees no difference between a gold or a stone. And you can see that practical realization through the life of Maharaj Ambarish. So Shraddha Mataji, I request you to nominate someone and then they can nominate someone for reading the next 10 verses.
So I don't know how much you heard, but I nominated Yashoda Kripa Prabhu because I see him right next to me on this gallery view.
Good. And then Yashoda Kripa Prabhu can nominate somebody else after he's done. Or both of them are done, or however you want to divide it up.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me?
Text 23, Yashoda Kripa
Prabhu. Yes. In the sacrifice arranged by Maharaj Ambarish, the members of the assembly and the priests, especially Hota, Udgata, Brahma, and Advaryu, were gorgeously dressed, and they all looked exactly like demigods. They eagerly saw to the proper performance of the yajna. The citizens of the state of Maharaj Ambarish were accustomed to chanting and hearing about the glorious activities of the personality of Godhead. Thus, they never aspired to be elevated to the heavenly planets, which are extremely dear even to the demigods. Those who are saturated with the transcendental happiness of rendering service to the Supreme Personality of Godhead are uninterested even in the achievements of great mystics, for such achievements do not enhance the transcendental bliss felt by a devotee who always thinks of Krishna within the core of his heart. 26. The king of this planet, Maharaj Ambarish, thus performed devotional service to the Lord, and in this endeavor, practiced severe austerity, always satisfying the Supreme Personality of Godhead by his constitutional activities. He gradually gave up all material desires. Maharaj Ambarish gave up all attachment to household affairs, wives, children, friends, and relatives, to the best of powerful elephants, to beautiful chariots, carts, horses, and inexhaustible jewels, and to ornaments, garments, and an inexhaustible treasury. he gave up attachment to all of them, regarding them as temporary and material. Being very pleased by the unalloyed devotion of Maharaj Ambarish, the Supreme Personality of Godhead gave the king his disc, which is fearful to enemies and which always protects the devotee from enemies and adversities. 29. To worship Lord Krishna, Maharaj Ambarish, along with his queen, who was equally qualified, observed the vow of Ekadashi and Dwadashi for 1 year. In the month of Kartik, after observing that vow for 1 year, after observing a fast for 3 nights, and after bathing in the Yamuna, Maharaj Ambarish worshipped the Supreme Personality of Godhead Hari in Madhuvan. 31-32. Following the regulative principles of Mahabhishek, Maharaj Ambarish performed the bathing ceremony for the deity of Lord Krishna with all paraphernalia, and then he dressed the deity with fine clothing, ornaments, fragrant flower garlands, and other paraphernalia for worship of the Lord. With attention and devotion, he worshipped Krishna and all the greatly fortunate Brahmanas who were free from material desires. Hare Krishna. Shall I continue?
Thank you. Hare Krishna. Next 10 verses, please. Because the action is not yet started. This is just the background of what's going to happen.
So I will nominate somebody in my list. For some reason, the person on my screen is Shamlangi Mataji. So I recommend her for next week.
Thank you, Prabhu. Text 33 to 35. Thereafter, Maharaj Ambarish satisfied all the guests who arrived at his house, especially the Brahmanas. He gave in charity 60 crores of cows whose horns were covered with gold plate and whose hooves were covered with silver plate. All the cows were well decorated with garments and had full milk bags. They were mild-natured, young and beautiful, and were accompanied by their calves. After giving these cows, the king first sumptuously fed all the Brahmanas, and when they were fully satisfied, he was about to observe the end of Ekadashi and with their permission by breaking the fast. Exactly at that time, however, Durvasa Muni, the great and powerful mystic, appeared at the scene as an uninvited guest.
So just let me just discuss a little
Chandra. Sure.
So if you really want to be tried, trying situations in life, then you should invite Durvasa Muni over. In Mahabharata, it's mentioned about Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni was extremely pleased when he was served properly, and he would give great boons. And he was easily irritated and displeased, and he would curse. The Pandavas, they were in the forest. The nature of envy is such that Duryodhana was constantly not enjoying the kingdom that he unfairly won from the Pandavas, but rather fixated on how to completely decimate Pandavas so that he can ensure that the kingdom is his to keep forever. He used to constantly send out spies and find out where they are and so on and so forth. One day he heard that Durvasa Muni was coming to Hastinapur. Usually Duryodhana was not a big fan of the sages, because the sages would come, they would influence the mind of his father, and he would do something rash, like making peace with the Pandavas or giving their kingdom back. In fact, which he does. But he found that there is no loophole to destroy Pandavas. And now he thought, you know, this is the good opportunity. He said to his servants, I personally will take care of Durvasa Muni. You don't take care of him. And Durvasa Muni came, and Duryodhana was taking care of him personally. Oh, Durvasa, as I said, if you want trying situations in life, he would wake up in the middle of night and he would tell the host, I am hungry, please prepare food. I'm going to the river to take bath and I'll come back. And then he would, the host would prepare and he would come back after some time and Durvasa would say, I'm not hungry. And then he would appear all of a sudden. Sometimes he would come by himself, sometimes with 60,000 people out of his disciples. Sometimes he was extremely guest of very finicky demands. And kings in those days, they had, that was their only power. The subjugation of kings would happen because the brahmanas would curse them. So they would be very, very careful of that. But in any case, Duryodhana gnashed his teeth and, you know, he controlled his ego. He tolerated the tantrums that Durvasa was throwing. And then for all the time that he stayed, somehow or other, he served Durvasa. And at the end, Durvasa Muni, he said, I am really appreciative of your service. What can I do for you? And in the meanwhile, Duryodhana had already talked to Karna, Dushasana, and Shakuni exactly what he wanted from Durvasa Muni. He said, you know, O Brahmana, O Supreme Person, O great mystic, you have given us darshan, your audience, but our poor cousins who are in the forest, you didn't give them any darshan. So please go visit them. But my only request is you visit them after Draupadi has taken her meal. And in the forest, I believe it was Dvaitavana, but I'm not sure which one. And the Pandavas, as we know the story of how Draupadi was given the Akshayapatra. The interesting history behind Akshayapatra is that when the five brothers lost their kingdom, a large number of Brahmanas followed Yudhishthir Maharaj. And in when Yudhishthir Maharaj was the king, every day 100,000 Brahmanas would be fed. And it's mentioned in Mahabharata, after a set number of Brahmanas were fed, the bells would be ringing. Hey, you know, this count is achieved. Like we ring our bells during the calling party car, you know, when we like distribute a Bhagavatam set or whatever. And then the bells were continuously ringing, which means a lot of number of Brahmanas were fed. When Yudhishthir Maharaj lost his kingdom, the Brahmana said, oh king, we'll come with you. And then Yudhishthir Maharaj said, I myself will not have any sustenance or hope. Please stay, you know, Duryodhana will take care of you. Because in those days, Brahmanas wouldn't actually work. They would be maintained by the king. But in any case, the Brahmanas instead, please don't worry, in the forest we'll find some roots and fruits and then we will continue. So don't worry, we'll take care of ourselves. Let's just come with you. Besides, you'll be alone in the forest. We'll give Bhagavatam classes every day. That was not the exact word used, but they said we'll narrate the histories of Upanishads and Puranas, and that way you'll be having a good time and enlivening spiritual discourses. And the Brahmanas were true to their word. They would go to the forest, they would try to find some roots and fruits to maintain themselves. Maharaj Yudhishthir's heart was just pierced by this. He said, when I was king, 100,000 Brahmanas would be fed every single day. And now, you know, I am responsible for them because Kshatriyas would still, forest, no forest, they would abide by the orders of Brahmana and it's their duty to maintain Brahmanas. And then his heart would be pierced. And then I believe it was Vashishta who said, you should pray to Sun God. He will help you. So Maharaj Yudhishthir actually stands on the river bank for 3 days and three nights without eating or without sleeping. And on the third day, Sun God comes. And then we know the story of how Akshayapatra is given to them and how it produces unlimited number of foodstuffs as long as Draupadi is not eaten. And so Durvasa Muni, and the Duryodhana, coming back to the story, Duryodhana's calculation was, I can't win them by fair, honest means because they are more powerful than me in fighting a war. I already done what I could do through unfair means. The gambling match is done. Now, the only way I can destroy them is actually through the sage's curse, because that, you know, it cannot be revoked, it cannot be diminished, it cannot be stopped by anybody. And Durvasa said, yes. And then the Pandavas were done for the day. As we know the story, I'll just cut short because we need to get back to our main story. And the Pandavas were done for the day. Draupadi had eaten. Durvasa comes in with 60,000 disciples and he tells Maharaj Yudhishthira, please, you know, start, you know, cook for us. We'll go to the river, take bath, and we'll come back. And in this, when the guests come home, the Matajis are in more anxiety than Prabhu's. just the nature. And Draupadi was in all anxiety. How can I do this? And Pandavas are also very in anxiety, but Draupadi, it was on her to kind of, take care of the guests, and she was in all anxiety. And then she utterly cries out to Krishna, and Krishna comes, hearing the plight of the Pandavas. And he says to Draupadi, Draupadi, I am hungry. Can you give me something to eat? And Draupadi says, I just came here to solve my problem. You say you are hungry. And Krishna says, no, I'm just really hungry. Get me something to eat. And as we know the story of, there was one small piece of rice with vegetable. And Krishna takes that. He puts it into the mouth. And he's completely satiated. Back in the riverbank, Durvasa and his 60,000 disciples feel as if like they had eaten a heavy meal. They can't even take one more morsel. They all decide what's going to happen, because Durvasa already remembers something happened in the past, that you should not, my Brahminical powers actually have serious, they are seriously ineffective in certain cases, and I shouldn't actually get involved with this kind of situation. And he has a flashback about what happened in the past, that he did something like this. And then, you know, he had to pay a deep price. So we'll get to see what that flashback was. So let's coming back to the story. Shyamalangi Mataji, please. I'll not interrupt till we are done with the story. So.
No, it's okay, Prabhu.
Yeah, good.
Okay. Text 36. After standing up to receive Durvasa Muni, King Ambarish offered him a seat and paraphernalia of worship. Then sitting at his feet, the king requested the great sage to eat. 37 translation. So Durvasa Muni gladly accepted the request of Maharaj Ambarish, but to perform the regulative ritualistic ceremonies, he went to the river Yamuna. Then he dipped into the water of the auspicious Yamuna and meditated upon the impersonal Brahman. In the meantime, only a muhurta of the Dwadashi day was left on which to break the fast. Consequently, it was imperative that the fast be broken immediately. In this dangerous situation, the king consulted learned Brahmana. The king said, to transgress the laws of respectful behavior towards the Brahmanas is certainly a great offense. On the other hand, if one does not observe the breaking of the fast within the time of the Dwadasi, there is a flaw in one's observance of the vow. Therefore, O Brahmanas, if you think that it will be auspicious and not irreligious, I shall break the fast by drinking water. In this way, after consulting with the Brahmanas, the king reached this decision, for according to Brahmanical opinion, drinking water may be accepted as eating and also not as eating. O best of the Kuru dynasty, after he drank some water, King Ambarish, meditating upon the Supreme Personality of Godhead within his heart, waited for the return of the great mystic Durvasa Muni. After executing the ritualistic ceremonies to be performed at noon, Durvasa returned from the bank of the Yamuna. The king received him well, offering all respects. But Durvasa Muni, by his mystic power, could understand that King Ambarish had drunk water without his permission. Still hungry, Durvasa Muni, his body trembling, his face curved and his eyebrows crooked in a frown, angrily spoke as follows to King Ambarish, who stood before him with folded hands. Prabhu, I think you told me 10 verses, so should I pass on to the next reader?
Yes, sure, Matthew, you call, yes.
Well, as per tradition, now I'm seeing Kautukarna Prabhu next to me. So maybe he can read then.
Where is next to read?
Oh, next.
Yeah. You did.
Hare Krishna. Text 44. Alas, just see the behavior of this cruel man. He is not a devotee of Lord Vishnu. Being proud of his material opulence and his position, he considers himself God. Just see how he has transgressed the laws of religion. Maharaj Ambarish, you have invited me to eat as a guest, but instead of feeding me, you yourself have eaten first. Because of your misbehavior, I shall show you something to punish you. As Durvasa Muni said this, his face became red with anger. Uprooting a bunch of hair from his head, he created a demon resembling the blazing fire of devastation to punish Maharaj Ambarish. Taking a trident in his hand and making the surface of the earth tremble with his footsteps, that blazing creature came before Maharaj Ambarish. But the king, upon seeing him, was not at all disturbed and did not move even slightly from his position. As fire in the forest immediately burns to ashes an angry snake, so by the previous order of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, his disc, the Sudarshan Chakra, immediately burned to ashes the created demon to protect the Lord's devotee. Upon seeing that his own attempt had failed and that the Sudarshan Chakra was moving toward him, Durvasa Muni became very frightened and began to run in all directions to save his life. As the blazing flames of a forest fire pursue a snake, the disc of the Supreme Personality of Godhead began following Durvasa Muni. Durvasa Muni saw that the disc was almost touching his back, and thus he ran very swiftly, desiring to enter a cave of Sumeru Mountain. Just to protect himself, Durvasa Muni fled everywhere, in all directions, in the sky, on the surface of the earth, in caves, in the ocean, on different planets of the rulers of the three worlds, and even on the heavenly planets. But wherever he went, he immediately saw following him the unbearable fire of the Sudarshan Chakra. With a fearful heart, Durvasa Muni went here and there seeking shelter. But when he could find no shelter, he finally approached Lord Brahma and said, "Oh my Lord, oh Lord Brahma, kindly protect me from the blazing Sudarshan Chakra sent by the Supreme Personality of Godhead." Maybe I am done providing. Thank you, Shiva Sindhu.
You have to nominate someone.
Akshay Prabhu.
Okay, sounds good.
Lord Brahma said, at the end of the Dvipraradha, Prararadha, when the pastimes of the Lord come to an end, Lord Vishnu, by a flick of his eyebrows, vanquishes the entire universe, including our places of residence. Such personalities as me and Lord Shiva, as well as Daksha, Bhrigu, and similar great saints of which they are the head, and also the rulers of the living entities, the rulers of human society, and the rulers of the demigods. All of us surrender to that Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Vishnu, bowing our heads to carry out his orders for the benefit of all living entities. When Durvasa, who was greatly afflicted by the blazing fire of the Sudarshan Chakra, was thus refused by Lord Brahma, he tried to take shelter of Lord Shiva, who always resides on his planet known as Kailash. Lord Shiva said, "My dear son, I, Lord Brahma, and the other demigods who rotate within this universe under the misconception of our greatness cannot exhibit any power to compete with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. For innumerable universes and their inhabitants come into existence and are annihilated by the simple direction of the Lord. Past, present, and future are known to me, Lord Shiva, Sanat Kumar, Narada, the most revered Lord Brahma, Kapila, the son of Devahuti, Apanta Ratma, Lord Vyasdev, Devala, Yamaraj, Asuri, Marichi, and many saintly persons headed by me, headed by him, as well as many others who have achieved perfection. Nonetheless, because we are covered by the illusory energy of the Lord, we cannot understand how expansive that illusory energy is. You should simply approach that Supreme Personality of Godhead to get relief, for this Sudarshan Chakra is intolerable even to us. Go to Lord Vishnu. He will certainly be kind enough to bestow all good fortune upon you.
So here, was Lord Brahma able to protect Durvasa?
No.
He said, what are you talking about? I come from the navel of Lord Vishnu. And I myself had to struggle for a lot of time just to find out who my creator was. And we remember the story of how in Brahma Samhita and other places, Lord Brahma, he was created and he dove in into the stem of the lotus to see the source from where the lotus was sprouting. And he couldn't find anything but darkness in all directions. And then he heard the word tapa. And then he started performing austerities. And the Lord personally showed him or gave him darshan. And it's very elaborately described in the third canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. When he begins the process of creation, he says, one of the fears that Brahma had was that if I create this universe, will I not be very proud? Because I'm in constant mode of passion, will I not become really proud and forget you while this creation? And actually Lord Vishnu assures him that you'll be safe because I'll give you that benediction. And so Lord Brahma says, forget it. And and then he goes, where does he go next to? To Lord Shiva. And Lord Shiva himself says, no, I cannot. You have to go to Lord Vishnu because Sudarshan Chakra is so powerful that it will destroy us. What to speak of you. So suggestion for Lord Vishnu. Let's see what happens as Durvasa is trying to eagerly save his life.
Who can ask a quick question on that? Don't mind.
Yes, please. Anybody can ask questions anytime.
Thanks, Prabhu. So when Brahmaji, he mentioned categorically that you go to Lord Vishnu, then what stopped Durvasa Muni? Could be his false ego or whatever, I don't know. But instead of going to Vishnu straight, he first went to Shiva and then he went to Vishnu when he was again told by Shiva.
No, Brahmaji didn't say, did Brahma say that you go directly to Lord Vishnu?
I think there's a line in there. I saw that.
He says, if you look up, let's look up the translation. It's a good point. Thank you. It's a nice point. I didn't observe that, but maybe we can see what Lord Brahma is saying here.
Which text was it?
It was little up, if you can go up. So this is all spoken by Lord Shiva. And then you can see maybe two or three verses, a little bit up more part.
This one? Oh.
No. Just go up on the same screen.
Go on. Is it this one?
Let me look up the verse number. No, just go to the advanced view that you had there.
Okay. Yeah.
No, the same screen from where the devotees were reading. If you can go to that screen.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. Be there. Just go up. Scroll a little bit up on the screen. And then... So here, though Lord Brahma specifically mentioned the glories of the Lord, Yashoda Kripa Prabhu, he did not give that direction. He just said, Lord Vishnu is the Supreme. And then he went to Lord Shiva. The other point of this pastime is that Srila Prabhupada writes in the purports that no matter how powerful, he just wanted to show the Bhagavatam shouldn't leave any doubt that whether Durvasa, oh, he missed Lord Shiva. If he had gone to Lord Shiva, maybe he would have got. So even to remove that sort of doubt, it was just clearly made sure. Brahma is the master of all demigods. And then above him is Rudra. So just, and everybody below would have been anyway ineffective. So to remove all that doubt, he just went. And then it was inspired by the Supreme Lord himself. So it happened like that. Is that okay? Yashoda Kripa Prabhu.
Yes, Prabhu, yeah, clear. Thank you.
All right, so is it Akshay who's reading?
Yes, Prabhu. Should I continue?
Yes, I think you should continue till where Kautkarna Prabhu says 10 verses. I don't know where he stopped. So.
63, I think.
Yeah.
63. Okay. Thereafter, being disappointed even in taking shelter of Lord Shiva, Durvasa Muni went to Vaikuntha Dham, where the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Narayana, resides with his consort, the Goddess of Fortune. Durvasa Muni, the great mystic, scorched by the heat of the Sudarshan Chakra, fell at the lotus feet of Narayana, his body trembling. He spoke as follows, O infallible, unlimited Lord, protector of the entire universe, you are the only desirable objective for all devotees. I am a great offender, my Lord. Please give me protection. O my Lord, O Supreme Controller, without knowledge of your unlimited prowess, I have offended your most dear devotee. Very kindly save me from the reaction of this offense. You can do everything, for even if a person is fit for going to hell, you can deliver him simply by awakening within his heart the holy name of your Lordship. The Supreme Personality of Godhead said to the Brahmana, I am completely under the control of my devotees. Indeed, I am not at all independent. Because my devotees are completely devoid of material desires, I sit only within the core of their hearts. What to speak of my devotee, even those who are devotees of my devotee are very dear to me.
So Bhagavatam has this unique phenomena or the unique aspect of Krishna where Krishna is captured and Krishna is defeated. That can only be possible in the pages of Bhagavatam. And here, please understand that in Lord Narayana is the Supreme Absolute Truth. He is, as Brahma said and as Lord Shiva said, he is their creator. He is Bhagavan. He is the last word on transcendence. Janmadhyasya yataha. Janmadhyasya yatonvayat itaratas charteshva abhijna and swarat. The first canto, first chapter, first verse of Srimad Bhagavatam, one of the defining features of that absolute truth is he is swarat, he is independent. So could he have saved Durvasa Muni from Sudarshan Chakra? Absolutely yes. You know, absolute is a term that we need to use it with a caution because no, absolutely means something that is undeniable. But in case of Krishna, yes, because he is the absolute truth, we can use absolutely with him. So, of course, he could have saved. He could have just withdrawn his Sudarshan Chakra because he sent it to him in the first place. Would Maharaj Ambarish feel offended? Oh my God, you know, he saved. No, he would have said, how wonderful is the Lord. In fact, that was Ambarish's ultimate goal, is to save this Brahmana Durvasa from the wrath of Sudarshan Chakra. And he would actually glorify Vishnu by saying, oh, wonderful, how wonderful my Lord is that, you know, he released Durvasa Muni from the Sudarshan Chakra. So there was no reason for Lord Vishnu to say that, I can't do anything about it. It's the idea there is that Lord Vishnu is defeated by the love of his devotee. And that comes unique in the page of Srimad Bhagavatam. And ninth canto actually leads that or segues into the 10th canto, where this idea of capturing Krishna comes from this 9th canto, where the Lord openly exhibits his deference to his own devotees. He says that aham bhakta paradhino, I am actually not independent. He rejects or he contradicts his own swarat in favor of being subjugated by the love of the devotee. So this is this unique, sweet nature of the Lord and his devotee, that Lord is not saying that if I say that I am dependent on my devotee, it really becomes so not condescending, it just diminishes my value. If a boss of the company or a CEO of the company who pays and who maintains the other employees, he never says, I am dependent on my employees. There is that false ego that I am the controller and owner and these people are dependent on me and I can let them go anytime. But Lord Vishnu is such transcendental, so sweet, that he says, no, I'm actually not independent. This is dependent on my devotees. I sit in the core of their heart. And we can see the beautiful, the heart of Lord Vishnu is actually being described here, and the heart of the devotees. So please continue. Shraddha Mataji, we stop at 6:15, 6:30. What's the time?
Hey, Krishna Prabhu, we stop at 6:15. So still 20 more minutes.
Perfect. Okay, we'll try our best to complete. I think we can complete, yes. All right. You have to nominate somebody, Akshay.
I see Pavan Kumar Prabhu, probably he can do it.
Yes. Pavan, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
You can actually increase your voice a little bit notch. Yeah, we can hear you, but we would like to hear you even better.
Okay.
If you can, if you are in a spot where you cannot read, then please nominate someone. No need to feel pressured. Pawanji.
After I'll read it, one second.
How is it now? Good? Better?
Yes, much better. So, text number 64. It's you can read and then I can explain a little bit.
Prabhu, maybe.
Okay, I'll read.
Oh, best of the Brahmanas. Without saintly persons for whom I am the only destination, I do not desire to enjoy my transcendental bliss and my supreme opulences.
And that if that was an ordinary person who was like, a millionaire or even like very really wealthy person who says, I do not really to enjoy, then, you know, sure, but here is the supreme absolute truth. He has unlimited number of opulences and he is the source of all transcendental bliss. But that same supreme absolute truth says that they are all not that relishable without the association of my devotees. Just to go, just to see how Krishna loves his devotees to the extent that it's just useless. In fact, in one of the scriptures, it is mentioned that Krishna, after a long separation from Radharani, knowing very well that she might be very upset and angry with him for having neglected her, he says, Kim karishyasi, kim vadishyasi, sa chiram virahena, kim dhanena, janena kim. Mama jivitena grihena. The Lord says that Krishna is in anxiety. what should I tell to Radharani? Kim kari, what should I do? She'll be really upset with me. Kim vadishyasi, what should I tell her? Here is the absolute truth from whom all the speech comes. Here is the absolute truth whose intelligence is unlimited. There is no limit to his intelligence. He says, what should I do? Kim karishyasi, kim vadishyasi. Sachiram virahena. I have neglected Srimati Radharani for a long time. Kim dhanena. What is the use of my wealth? Kim janena. What is the use of all these followers or my family members? Krishna is mamayavamsha jiva loke. So pretty much the entire existence with unlimited number of souls is his family members. Pitamasya jagata mata data pitama. Says, what is the use of all these people? Kim dhanena janena kim. And so much so Krishna says, what is the use of my life? Kim dhanena janena kim mama jivitena grihena. He says, what's the use of all this? So the Lord's love for his devotees, his own promises, his own Aishwarya Bhav, completely subjugated by the love of his devotees. And to give that sort of love, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came, which was completely unknown in the Vedas. And that's the reason why he's called most munificent incarnation, to even reach a position where a devotee is quote unquote higher than the Supreme Personality of Godhead, in that sense captured by the love, the Lord becomes subordinate to his devotee. So this is such a beautiful lesson that we gradually see from the external aspect of Krishna. Now we enter into the heart of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. And these are his own words that he's saying regarding why he's unable to save Durvasana. Just to glorify Maharaj Amrish to the extent that my devotee is so precious to me. And by that stretch of imagination, anybody who actually tries to serve Krishna and anybody who tries to understand and serve the Lord is very, very dear and precious to the Lord. And he says that one devotee of mine has no comparison to all the wealth of the universes put together. That is Krishna's heart. And when we perform devotional service to Krishna, that is our goal in understanding Krishna. Questions? Any comments? We'll just complete this particular section and then we'll take. Go ahead, Pawani.
Such pure devotees give up their homes, wives, children, relatives, riches, and even their lives simply to serve me without any desire to material improvement in this life or in the next. How can I give up such devotees at any time? As chaste women bring their gentle husbands under control by service, the pure devotees who are equal to everyone and completely attached to me in the core of the heart, bring me under their full control. My devotees who are always satisfied to be engaged in my loving service are not interested even in the four principles of liberation: Salokya, Sarukya, Samipya, Sashtya. Although these are automatically achieved by their service, what then is to be said of such perishable happiness as allegation to the higher planetary systems? The pure devotee is always within the core of my heart, and I am always in the heart of the pure devotee. My devotees do not know anything else but me, and I do not know anything else but them. O Brahman.
So one point here is the Lord says here, sadavo hridayam mahiyam sadunam hridayam toham madanyatena jananti naham te bhyo managapi. It might be a little contradictory that when Krishna says, I do not know anything then doesn't the Lord say in the Bhagavad Gita, 7th chapter, 25th verse, Vedaham samatitani vartamanani cha Arjuna bhavishyani cha bhutani mam tu vedana kashchana. He says that, oh Arjuna, I have known everything that's happened in the past and everything that's happening now and everything that is to happen. Here, please understand that Krishna, in his essence, in his in the most highest of his pastimes, has only knowledge of his devotees, and he relishes that loving relationship. That is the Lord. While there are unlimited expansions of the Lord, like the Paramatma or the Purusha expansions, who create and maintain these universes and monitor all the activities of the Jiva. But in essence, the Lord is completely absorbed in loving relationships with his devotees. And he says, that's all I know. I don't need to know anything else. In fact, in Srimad Bhagavatam, we see that Brahma comes after offending the Lord. And we know the story of Brahma Vimohan. Yeah, he comes. And Chaitanya Charitamrita says, such beautiful prayers that he offers. He is the most intelligent person. He, in fact, after Krishna, it's Lord Brahma who is in the disciplic succession. So he will know a lot about Krishna, and he offers the choicest poems and shlokas in praising Krishna. And those, Chaitanya Charitamrita says, actually constitute the Vedic, entire Vedic knowledge in those verses of Brahmaji when he offers those prayers to Krishna. And after offering these wonderful prayers, the Lord is like that small five-year-old boy. In his left hand, he's holding the curd rice, and he's just looking at Brahma. He's neither acknowledging those prayers, neither is he saying very good prayers or pathetic prayers or nothing. The Lord is extremely quiet. He's not saying a word. And because in fact, if you offend someone and you go and apologize, the first thing you would like to have is elicit some response, whether that person was satisfied with my apology or, you know, was he not, right? It's very natural. And Lord Krishna was completely quiet. And the acharyas explain that Lord Krishna is thinking, who is this four-headed person and why is he offering me prayers? I am looking for my friends. I'm searching for my calves. I'm searching for the cows. And I'm eagerly trying to find them, and this four-headed person is coming to me offering these prayers. Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur says that the Lord is so absorbed in the mood of Vrindavan that he forgets his own Aishwarya. He forgets that he has, from him or from one of his incarnations, Brahma has come. It just goes to highlight this point that the highest acme of Krishna's pastime is with his devotees. And Krishna knows his devotees, and his devotees know him only. And that's to that. There is nothing beyond that. In fact, in the other story of it's given in Chaitanya Charitamrita, is that, you know, we know the story of Rasa dance and how the gopis, you know, they were enjoying the Rasa dance with Krishna, and it was almost one night of Brahma, and almost like one day of Brahma amount. And at the end of that time, each gopi thought that Krishna was with him only. And Krishna suddenly left the arena, and the gopis were plunged into such despair. And they started asking the trees, the creepers, the deer, Yamuna, the dust, have you seen Krishna? And then as Krishna is hiding in the bushes, the gopis approach him. Krishna actually wants to play a trick on them. He assumes the four-handed form of Lord Narayana, and he's standing. And the gopis, they saw Lord Narayana, and they fall down to the ground. They offer prayers, and it's mentioned they offer stuti or praises to Lord Vishnu in the four-handed form Narayana. And after offering the prayers, they said, O Lord Narayana, have you seen Krishna? Where did Krishna go? The idea is, and then it is mentioned how Krishna, when Radharani came, Krishna struggled. He couldn't maintain his composure, his Aishwarya Bhav of Narayana, and he had to revert back to his two-handed form. So again, defeated by the love of his devotees is the theme of Srimad Bhagavatam. And it is mentioned here how the devotees know only Krishna and Krishna knows the devotee. So this is where it is mentioned. It's that I do not know anything else other than my devotees. We have about 9 more minutes. So let's complete that pastime and then we can take more questions or stuff.
Hare Krishna, Srivas Pandit Prabhu. Thank you so much for choosing such a fantastic topic today. I was just reflecting on Yashoda Kripa Prabhu's comment on, when he thought that Brahmaji, why did Durvasa not go and meet Krishna directly and said, Vari Guru Shiva, and was it his ego that was working? And then you pointed us out that, you know, he had not specifically told him that. And I was also wondering that how these exalted personalities are so smart that they won't give instructions because they know it won't be followed.
That's a good one.
Yeah. He just indirectly said that I go there. He didn't say that you go there. Like that.
Yeah, it's a beautiful point that you made. I want to quickly wrap up in next 3 minutes, at least this pastime, so we can bring it to a conclusion and then we can do more reflections or questions. So can I ask Gandharika Mataji to read, please, the next 10 verses? Or anybody. Or Shama Rupa Prabhu. Anybody's fine. That's what I tried to wrap up.
In some mission college, we went and I sang, and I was like, what's your problem? What's wrong with me?
All right. Shama Rupa Prabhu, please.
Tip 68. The pure devotee is always within the core of my heart. And I am always in the heart of the pure devotee. My devotees do not know anything else but me, and I do not know anyone else but them. Text 69. O Brahmana, let me now advise you for your own protection. Please hear from me. By offending Maharaj Ambarish, you have acted with self-envy. Therefore, you should go to him immediately without a moment's delay. One so-called prowess, when employed against the devotee, certainly harms he who employs it. Thus, it is the subject, not the object, who is harmed.
Thank you. Shyamala Prabhu, I'm so sorry to interrupt you. So please carry on. So one thing is, one so-called prowess when employed against the devotee certainly harms he who employs it. The same thing happened with Duryodhana when he tried to poison Bhima. And we know the story of how Bhima was a voracious eater. And Duryodhana had... Go ahead, Shyamala Prabhu, you can close. I'll read the rest of it and I can complete it.
For a Brahmana, austerity and learning are certainly auspicious. But when acquired by a person who is not gentle, such austerity and learning are most dangerous.
Thank you. So as I was mentioning the story of Bhima and Duryodhana, how Bhima tried to kill Duryodhana tried to kill Bhima. And it is mentioned that they went for a picnic along the bank of the river. And then, you know, Duryodhana had cooks prepare cakes and put poison in the cake. And it is mentioned that the poison in one cake was enough to kill 100 people. And he took 100 such cakes actually before Bhima became groggy or unconscious. Otherwise, Duryodhana was flabbergasted. Bhima was eating cake after cake, and then he was not having any effect at all. And then at last he became groggy, and they tied him and threw him to the bottom of the Ganges. And we know the story of how he goes to the Nagaloka. The Nagaloka, actually the serpents, they bite him because they think that he's an intruder that has come. And the serpents actually bite Bhima. And lo and behold, Bhima actually awakens and all the effects of the poison are neutralized. Shocked, what happened here? So Duryodhana fed plant-based poison to Bhima, and the antidote is the venom of the serpent. So actually the serpent biting revived Bhima rather than actually killing him further. So just goes to that same point. Go ahead, Shyamarup Bros. Sorry, just we can be clear. Yeah.
Text 71, this is the last sloka. O best of the Brahmanas, you should therefore go immediately to King Ambarisha, the son of Maharaj Navaga. I wish you all good fortune. If you can satisfy Maharaj Ambarish, then there will be peace for you.
Thank you. So we hear the story of how Maharaj Ambarish is waiting for Durvasa, and Durvasa goes and falls at his feet. And how Maharaj Ambarish prays to Sudarshan Chakra. He offers beautiful prayers to Sudarshan Chakra. And he says, please, you know, release this Brahmana. And Sudarshan Chakra is satisfied, and he goes back to Vaikuntha planet. The other point that we can, or the other lesson, in many places we hear that a Vaishnava is greater than a Brahmana. And this is the practical proof of how Durvasa thought that because I am a Brahmana and this person is a king, a kshatriya, who is much lower than me, and how dare he offend me. So this mentality was caused by...
Otherwise, there is so many...
When you have this kind of mystic powers or siddhis, and then that kind of power, then pride automatically comes in. And that's the reason why Krishna... Even though one performs devotional service and one is really in a very exalted state in one's own sadhana or devotion, apparently from an external perspective, they seem to be really devoid of any sort of powers or any sort of flash or jazz or, you know, mystic siddhis, because Krishna withholds them. He doesn't give it to them. He thinks that by giving it to these people, then he'll forget me. I will rather have the relationship with my devotee, rather gives them mystic powers. Just like a mother who makes sure that the child, while getting a healthy dose of junk, doesn't subsist on junk 24/7, knowing well that it will actually spoil their health. In the same way, excessive mystic powers, excessive opulences, these are really, really going to be not conducive for a devotee. And the devotee says, I don't want it either. And for those who are really sincere, Krishna doesn't give them fame, doesn't give them limelight, doesn't give them too much of worldly glories, knowing well that the devotee can stray from that path. And so we can see in this point that how Durvasa Muni, even though he was a Brahmana and Maharaj Ambarish was a Kshatriya, from the perspective of the Supreme Lord, he was much higher. And what is the point in having these titles of Brahmana or Kshatriya if the Supreme Lord is not satisfied by those? And this is what it is said, that Brahmana is much greater than a Vaishnava. So you're all Vaishnavas. You're much greater than all the Brahmanas. So just keep up your devotion to Lord Vishnu. And ultimately, you'll please him. It really doesn't matter whether one is born in a high class, low class, having wealth, no wealth, having mystic powers and no mystic powers. The other lesson we learned is this. Maharaj Ambarish was fearless. When Durvasa Muni created the demon to be killed, Maharaj Ambarish didn't call for an army. Soldiers, come on, take on this. He didn't say anything. He was just standing with folded hands. Whereas Durvasa, when attacked by Sudarshan Chakra, he ran all over. He couldn't have that same fearless. Narayana parasarve nakutaschana bibhyati swarga pavarga narkeshu tulyarta apidarshinaha. That the devotees are fearless because they feel the protection of the Lord at all times, whereas those who are not there, and it's shown clearly that Durvasa was so afraid of dying, of giving up this body, that he was changed all over the place. So many beautiful lessons that we can learn from this. And it's 6:16. So any questions? And then anything else? Yeah, we discussed all the 4 points that, you know, Brahmanas are greater than Vaishnava, Durvasa couldn't find any shelter even amongst the demigods, and he had to go to Lord Vishnu, and Lord Vishnu said, I am bound by my devotees, so you need to seek shelter from my devotees. And Durvasa Muni comes back, and it just shows the glory, greatness of the devotees, the power, and the heart of the Supreme Lord, who values his devotees so much to the point that he says that nothing else matters to me except my devotees. So I'm so grateful to each and every one of you for joining the class today. Any questions, any comments, any...
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. So Prabhuji, one thing I was just noticing in the case of Duryodhan. So he repeatedly pleased many like great souls, of course, for his own purpose, like Balaram he pleased, Durvasa he pleased, and again, you know, Hiranyakashipu pleased Brahma. So it seems like, you know, they are very expert when they want something pleasing, whereas of course devotees, you know, they serve, but that seems to be like a skill they have. So my question is, can devotees of course devotees please in a much different level, but how to acquire that kind of course the motivation is wrong there, but you know, the external endeavor, whatever they put, seems to be working, at least in temporarily placing.
I think that is a talk you can give Shama Rupa Prabhu sometime, on how to please the devotees. Because every opportunity you see, you will try to get the devotees to the area, and you'll try to host them wherever possible. You try to organize katha. You glorify devotees wherever you get the chance. So I think it's definitely you can give a class on how you do it, so we all can learn from you. It's really, I have seen it practically with my two eyes. So you know, it's a good quality that you have. So yeah, but it's amazing. The other thing is that, as you so rightly mentioned, when the object you serve for is achieved, then you actually forget the person who gave you that. And Hiranyakashipu never had any mention of worshipping Lord Brahma in an unconditional way once he got his opulences. So the worship of demigods is like that. Kama. So they just want quick success. Demigods give them quick success, and after that they are done. Till another problem comes up, and the demigods will say, "All right, take it." But the demigods might withhold the actual mercy. Brahma didn't preach to Hiranyakashipu, Why are you wasting your time? So thank you. That's a nice question. Other questions, comments?
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, there's a question for you on our portal. So Kautukarna Prabhuji asks that, what is the meaning of Dvi Parartha from 9.4.53.54?
So as we know, from Bhagavad Gita, Sahasra Yuga Paryantam, and from the eighth chapter, we have the lifetime of Brahma, and we can see how Brahma's day is fantastically long, where 14 Manus come and go and so on and so forth, and Brahma lives for 100 such years. So each of those 100 years is divided into a 50-year period called Parartha. So the Brahma's life in that sense is Viparartha, which means 2 times 50. And according to the calculation, Brahmaji's first Parartha is done, and then he is in his second Parartha. So that is Dviparartha. So his lifespan, he's saying, I just live for 100 years or Dviparartha. So, and then after that, you know, my own planet is destroyed. Is that okay?
Thank you so much, Prabhu.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, this is Dhira Prashant Prabhuji. I just wanted
to thank Dhira Prashant Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, just a couple of reflections I want to mention. So Dhruvasa Muni seems like a very, very interesting rishi.
You can say that again.
Yeah, he just gives boons and, you know, bane, just like that, right? But one of the things that I was very impressed is, you know, when he goes back to the Lord and he says, please forgive me, right? You know, I please save this Sudarshana Chakra. Instead of Lord, you know, taking in his hands, right? He redirects it to Ambarish Maharaj, and he says, you know, go beg his and beg him, fall on his feet. And I was thinking how, you know, we have to take it very seriously, right? Not talk about devotees, you know, not offend devotees, right? Can you guys hear me? Sorry. Can you all hear me properly?
Yes, Prabhu.
Yeah. Sorry, I don't know what's happening to my video. It's not coming. So I was thinking, you know, how it's, you know, we have to take it very seriously, right? Not only offend devotees, but not talking in the back of them, you know, not talking anything, you know, that is unhealthy towards a spiritual relationship. And the last thing was even Maharaj Ambarish, right? All through this course of, Dhruvasa Muni, you know, trying to go to each and every, you know, demigod and begging them. Then he comes back, right? And he says, he still wants to save him. I was thinking how elevated his consciousness was, right? Not, he didn't take it personally and all that. And he says, like, if my love is true and pure and my feelings are same, then, you know, this chakra will return. And ultimately, a devotee saved him. So, yeah. Nice lessons.
And then when he goes to, when Dhruvasa goes to Vaikuntha, the Lord is not angry or upset or something like that. He's very gentle. He's calm. He says, because Krishna says, Samoham Sarva Bhuteshu. He says, while I want good fortune for you, but, you know, it's only possible when you fall at the feet of Ambarish. And just to add to the note, you know, Gaudiya Vaishnavas, we all will have a soft spot for Dhruvasa Muni, nevertheless, because he blessed Srimati Radharani with the boon that, you know, whoever eats your cooking never falls. never falls sick. And then Yashoda, knowing this secret, knowing this trait of Srimati Radharani, used to call him frequently to her house so that she can cook for Krishna so that her son will not fall sick. So in that sense also, while we learn lessons, we do have offer our obeisances to Dhruvasa Muni also. For his role in enhancing the pastimes of Radha and Krishna. They are all exalted souls. We don't unnecessarily criticize, but nevertheless, just goes to prove that don't mess with the devotees of the Lord.
yes, Lord. Thank you so much.
I'm so grateful to all of you. Sorry, it went a little over time. Any other questions? Comments?
Oh, one comment, please. I can share a reflection.
Yes, please.
Well, thank you for picking up this beautiful narration. Just as a coincidence, Mantra Siddhi and I were reading this just a few days ago. And one particular shloka was this. I kept on thinking for the last couple of days, and somehow we picked up this chapter today, which is the shloka 64, actually, where Krishna says that, I do not desire to enjoy my transcendental bliss and my supreme opulence without my, you know, saintly persons who I love to associate with. So on one hand, we are seeing he's the most powerful person, Satchinananda Vigraha. He's that's how he enjoys. His only work is to enjoy the world. He herds the cows, he dances, he breaks the pots, but he just enjoys. But he enjoys only when he gets the association of his devotees. And that's how he's proving his dependence on the devotees.
Nice point. Very nice point. Beautiful point. And in fact, the Aradhyo Bhagavan Rajesha Tanayas Taddhama Vrindavanam verse, and Ramya Kachid Upasana Vrajavada Vargena Vakalpita. The highest form of worship of Krishna is by the gopis of Vrindavan. And you can see that that particular land is completely devoid of his Aishwarya Bhava or opulences. He just wants to enjoy with his friends. And he is so absorbed in that mood that he is willing, or he actually casts aside his Aishwarya Bhava. I don't really want to even show off to the littlest extent that I am God in this beautiful land of Vrindavan. So that is the Lord's mood. And so that's why he says that I don't care about all my opulences as long as I get association. And the devotees, they're also in the same reciprocation mode. They say, he is no God. He's just saying, God, this is Krishna. He's no God. He's just our friend or my son or our lover. So that mood is reciprocal. But thank you for bringing up that point. Any other reflections, questions, or comments? All right. Thank you so very much.
Huh? Obhiji, like this month, Purushottam month, we decide Chaurashtakam. So you are saying that Krishna not necessarily give the devotees, he may withhold because that's like a junk. You give a very nice example. I really loved it, like junk may. So Chaurashtakam has that one verse, like Padashritam. I can't remember the whole verse, but it says like Padashritam, whoever takes shelter in Krishna.
Akinchane kritya padashritam ya. Akinchane kritya padashritam ya. Karoti bhikshum pati gehahinam. Kenapyaho bhishana chorayidre. Akinchane kritya padashritamya. Those who take shelter of your lotus feet, you make them akinchana, or you make them completely devoid of all opulences. Karoti bhikshum patigeha hinam. You make them beggars, you make them homeless beggars. And I have never seen a thief like this, that whoever takes shelter of your feet, they become completely homeless beggars. This is a really very fearful thief. That's such a sweet song. Yes. Thank you. Thank you. That's really nice.
Hare Krishna Prabhu, I really liked your example on verse 68, that when Krishna is in the mood of loving exchanges, he doesn't even remember his own pastimes of Purushavatara. The example that you gave for Brahma Vimohan Leela, that was really, really nice, Guru. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. That is what Srila Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur writes for that silence. So thank you. Any other final questions? I see Simi Mataji. Hare Krishna. Nice to meet you, Mataji. Gandhari Kanasji. Prasamrita Sesha Prabhu, Shamrup Prabhu, Krishna Mataji, Shamalang Mataji, Hare Krishna. And thank you, Parth and Aprame, for so nicely arranging for this.
Thank you for an encouraging class, Prabhu.
No, thank you. I praying that the Supreme Personality of Godhead may ever protect all those who take shelter of Him. And may He give us strength to get through these troubled times. And may we always be absorbed in chanting His holy name and hearing about His pastimes and be fearless in that particular situation, like King Ambarish was when his life was threatened. Thank you, Krishna, for considering this request. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna.
Thank you for coming and partying.